们尽情分享到最深的地方，愿你的生命宁静温暖如海洋。
因为小聚，我们今天非常非常的开心哦。我们访问到的是剧场界的巨擘欧丁剧场的创办人尤金爸爸，非常开心，非常开心，您能够接受我们的访问，谢谢您，这么多次来到台湾，为台湾，创造了，一个非常好的一个表演学习的这个机会。那我们想借这个机会，请你跟我们谈一谈，就是说，在欧丁剧场当初创办的这个过程。
I'm born in Italy, but I migrated to Norway when I was 18 years old. I've been a worker there. I was a welder and a sailor on a merchant fleet. Then I started studying at the university. And when I finished my studies, I decided to do theater. There was no school in Norway for directors.So I went to Poland. I studied 4 years in Poland, and I was collaborating at that time with a very young, anonymous, not known director, theater director, whose name was Jerzy Grotowski, who later became very, very famous. Then I came back after 4 years to Norway. I started the Odin Theatre with the young.People refused from a theater school. So we began as an amateur theater. And we began to train. I started training my young actors, would-be actors. We made a production, a new production. We started traveling in Scandinavia. And then we received the proposition from a small town in Denmark.To settle down there and do our activity there. So the Odin Theatre, its origin is of an amateur theatre which want to be professional and then left the country of origin with its own language, the audience they knew, and moved to a foreign country, Denmark, where we had to adapt to a new culture.And also to find a solution to the fact that the spectators didn't understand our Norwegian language or my actors.
我想，剧场对于我们一般来讲啊，它是一个，似乎是一个真实的空间，可是又是一个虚拟的空间哈。那在这里面呢，我们可以看到，各个不同的人类的这个，内在、外在的情绪、生活的情节。那怎么去谈？你怎么去定义一个剧场，或者说你怎么样让一个剧场能够真实的一个感动啊到观众
？For me, theater was a place or a situation where I could preserve my diversity. I was in Norway.And the Norwegian culture, Norwegian people behave in a certain way, very different from my way of behaving, thinking. And all the time, living there, working there, I noticed this. And people made me notice it. There was always a different way of treating me. Sometimes it was very generous, very open, as towards a foreigner, welcoming. Other times was of rejection and of racism.They're refusing and despising me. So I don't try to solve this. For me, theater became, or art, became the filter, the mask, which in a way took away my racial or national personality. And I became an artist. And an artist must be diverse.Must be different than other people. So when people now look at me, they don't say, oh, this is an Italian. They say, oh, this is a theater artist, very often, from Italy. So theater was for me the possibility of doing what I want, to think what I feel, and first of all, to build relationships, which I was longing for, working relationships, the work.Like an artisan which is doing perfectly what he's doing. The pride is in making something that not even an expert will discover. This is what still unites us, of the Odin, in doing our work.
您在整个的接触戏剧的过程哦，中间你有一段时间，你刚才也谈到你跟这个 Gotovsky 的学习，你可以谈谈，就是说，他对于这个戏剧的教法，或者说对戏剧的观念，对您的影响。
I met Gotovsky when he was very young and still not famous. He was only 2 years older than me. He was 28, I was 26. So the 3 years I spent together with him were the years where he changed the way of working with his actors, of seeing theater, and the results, the performances did. When they began to be known abroad, they also changed the European Western theater, but not only Western, they completely transformed the first seed from which all the variety of contemporary theater exists. He was very demanding. He was he had a sort of paradoxical way of thinking, which I liked very much. I found an affinity in it was something which was both very philosophical and at the same time very infantile, like a childish. It was very, very beautiful, this from sometimes almost cynical looking of what it is, like a description of, let's say, of love. So this was this double view of Grotowski, which fell within also what was my view of my experience, of my feeling of life, and which had attracted me towards Hinduism and Buddhism when I was young. What Grotowski did, which is very, very important for European theater, was that he at a certain moment stopped doing performances. He didn't produce results. But he continues to be active, only concentrating on the process, on what a Western, a Russian theater director, who is in reality the ancestor of all contemporary theater in the world, Stanislavski, said or called the work of the actor on himself, on herself. All the work an actor must do in order to be efficient, sensorially, mentally, spiritually efficient on the spectator. This work on oneself is the preparation. Think of the Peking Opera, all the hard training an actor, 10 years, and how he's still every day, a part of the day, is dedicated to keep this sort of physical, but not only physical, I would say. It is something beyond the physical, because it's not gymnastics. Skill, capacity of behaving is sensorial, sensual, almost animal impact on the spectator. So Grotowski indicated a way for theater people that theater is not only the results, the performance, the aesthetical, the artistic, the social, but also a sort of personal, almost yoga-like process. And for many, many young people, this practice and vision of Grotowski is meant, still means very much.
是，我想知道，就是说在，您的这个表演的训练哦，是非常非常严格的哦。那而且您也创造了很多不同的一种表演的一种训练的方式啊。但是我很想知道，先知道是说，您怎么样去看，就是说在舞台上的一个演员哦，怎么样算是一个好的演员
？For me, what I consider very important, the most important quality of an actor is abnegation.Is a sort of capacity of giving the maximum. It's a sort of alpinist, someone climbing a mountain. You don't know why you're climbing a mountain, being there alone in the snow, in the torment, away from your wife, risking your life, just to come on the top, remain a few minutes, and then go down. Why you want to climb the Everest? But it's a need. For me,The actor I want is someone who has certain need, he doesn't know why, he formulates in different, maybe banal ways, he wants to express himself, he wants to be useful to society, he wants to help people. But in reality, some sort of personal virus in him, there is a virus, a sort of fever or fire.And he is able to accept a very hard discipline, capacity of being a very strong individualist, and same time having the skill to collaborate, so that the performance become a living organism, which collaborate, which is living, alive, organically melting together, but where you can see clearly.The individual contribution. This is, for me, what is my experience of my work with my actors. But this is my experience and my need. Other directors will have other needs. And they are also, it's right, because this makes the theater landscapes is so rich of manifestations and expressions.
训练啊，要达到像您所讲的这样的一个要求，其实是非常非常严格的啊。那其中有一个部分就是说，我相信就是在很多我们台湾的，尤其受过很长时间的传统训练的这些演员，尤其像京剧的演员啊，他们很难做到一个就是您所想做的就是打破与切割、啊。那这些部分对于一个演员来的重要性，可不可以跟我们谈一下
？There are when you are an actor, you have only two ways.To express yourself. This is all over the world. This is in spite of your national or cultural identity. You can be Chinese, you can be Italian, you can be from South Africa, but if you are actor, there are only two ways to express yourself. There are two conventions. Mm-hmm. One convention is there is a tradition which gives you the form, and you through these forms you express yourself. Peking opera, tradition has created the forms, and you learn them, long training, 8-10 years, and then you express yourself through it. Classical ballet, Katakali, pantomime. So in each country, each culture has this traditional codified, you could say codified forms. The other convention is that there are no forms. Contemporary theater is this. So you have to invent the forms. And through these forms, which you have been inventing, you express yourself or the text. If you have been, let's say, ballet dancer, or baking opera actor, and then you want to leave these forms, then you are leaving a huge, huge richness, and then you will be as vulnerable as the young person begins to do theater and he has to invent theater. Each generation today has to invent theater, the forms or the knowledge, because there are no longer certain precise patterns which can be taught, as for instance in Peking opera, classical ballet. And this is the tragedy, I would say, of a performer who has been trained in a traditional form. That at the moment he leaves the traditional forms, he must be aware that in these traditional forms it exists all a lot of when you learn with the body. So a form is a bodily expression, apparently meaningless, and which through the text, the music, the context acquires a meaning. But in this form, there is an information. This is a dynamic information. This dynamic information is perceived by the nervous system of the spectator. It is as the heart of the dance. What makes the dance always has an impact on somebody watching, in spite that it doesn't tell a story. How to protect this dynamic information which the traditional form contains? There lies the real challenge. Are you able to take, let's say, Peking opera and then change it, the external form, but being able to keep this extraordinary glowing power of presence and efficacy, efficiency when it comes to direct impact on the senses of the spectator? Because theater is first of all a meeting between two living organisms, the actor and the spectator. And living organisms react at the first sight through a sensorial, through their senses. The theater is the art of the five senses.
Wow. That's great. 我知道您现在就是说在全世界各地啊也都做旅行跟教学啊，那您也提出了就是说这个剧场人类学这样的一个观点，可不可以谈谈就是说您这样的一个观点，以及您不断的用这样的一个观点去让很多的全世界各地的不同的这个表演的人才啊能够去学到一些对于戏剧或对他们自己生命的一些启发，可以不跟谈跟我们谈谈这个剧场人类学的一个观点。
When we see different cultures, these cultures have different form for representations, for performances. There are different types of actors, performers. And then, if I'm Italian, I want to learn from an actor of Peking opera. I look and I find they're fantastic. How can they help me in being, in making possible my personal way of being an actor without just becoming a Peking opera actor. There is. So, theater anthropology is the studies of what is behind the forms. I see a form, I see Peking opera, and the actor is a different form, a style. I see classical ballet, it's a different style. But behind these two very, very different styles, there are similar principles. I would say, you are different from me. I am different. Our way of speaking, expressing, liking food, treating other human beings is different. If you take away all this and take my heart, my pulsing, boom, 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 heart here on the table, and your pulsing heart on the table, it's no difference. So, what is the heart which makes technically possible that these two different forms, classical ballet and Peking opera, are alive for the spectator? It's just the skill, the talent of the actor, yes. There is also the convention, the tradition, Peking opera, classical ballet. But there is a third factor. The third factor is that both the actor of Peking opera and the dancer of classical ballet, they have a body in life. And they have to work with this presence in such a way that they use certain principles that make their daily behavior slightly different, or even very different from the daily life, and stylized, but according to certain rules. These rules are changing of balance, a certain way of building certain oppositions, a certain way of being building an incoherence, which is coherent. It's very strange to very incoherent to move, to walk like Peking opera, just like it's very incoherent to dance on the toes like classical dancing. But then it becomes coherent to the point that the spectator almost believes that the only way of being so light is to walk like this. So there are certain principles, and this is theater anthropology, which helps to find the principles, to discover the principles in what you are seeing beyond the forms, and then using these principles in order to build your own personal, professional identity, which is only unique and belongs only to you.